I will be showing you beta builds. So the builds that we're having a look at are out of the daily build branch for the beta release. I caveat both this session and the session that Hadley Pettigrew and I'll be presenting to you later in the morning with the fact this is really early stuff, guys. So we do know there is some stuff that doesn't work, and we may find some other exciting eventualities as we go along. Please do not tweet and blog this one. Please wait until after the beta actually releases, just because we're kind of a little bit special here in little old New Zealand. And I really don't want to get told off for showing stuff that maybe hasn't been totally announced yet. So we're going to run through, talk about some customer scenarios, talk about what the release time frame is for CRM 2011. Then we're going to run through the new features, including some slides on them and some demos using a hosted copy of CRM 2011. So who uses CRM already? So as well as working at Intergen, which I hope you kind of got, I'm a big fan of CRM. I own a company called MedRecruit. We're a medical recruitment agency. We're the second fastest growing company in New Zealand last year in Deloitte Fast 50. Our entire business is built on top of Microsoft Dynamics CRM 4. One of the reasons I'm pretty well geared up to show you the CRM 2011 stuff is at Intergen we've been writing all of the training content for Microsoft in the US for CRM 2011. So we've been working with really early builds of this for well over 12 months. The focus with CRM 2011 obviously is a big push towards the cloud. So CRM 2011 is going to be delivered first in a cloud format. You're going to be able to pick it up in cloud form before you pick it up to install on-premise. God, it was really bad. Obviously, a bunch of delivery platforms, PC, the Outlook experience is massively upgraded. The browser still is the primary experience for Dynamics CRM 2011. And it is still IE only. And the phone is also getting a pretty good revamp. So there is now native support for the Mobile Express UI and designer support for the Mobile Express UI baked into CRM 2011. So let's start by having a look at a bit of a scenario application that that my team built for Microsoft actually about 12 months ago for some of the really early builds of CRM 2011. And the idea was to show off what does it look like when you have CRM potentially on-premise, plus maybe some stuff running in Windows Azure. So the scenario is a low-cost telco company working very hard to drive down costs. Not your typical telecom company in that they're not a mobile virtual network operator. They do actually run their own cellular towers. So they want to really lower costs. So they've built their own portal, and they host that portal in Windows Azure. So the goal is that their customers are able to come to Windows Azure, log into that portal, and have that portal actually authenticate against an on-premise CRM system, communicating through the Windows Azure App Fabric Service Bus. So there may be a firewall here. That on-premise system is going to be able to communicate to contractors who can then go and fix cellular towers when they fail, and ultimately update the CRM system, update the portal, and communicate that information back to the customer. This is going to play nicely. So we've got a bit of a video here. This is hosted in Windows Azure. The goal here is that we have an ability to massively scale out in Windows Azure. We're going to log in here. We're logging in against a piece of data stored in a CRM contact entity. Hopefully people have built a system like that, right? Web-based portals fronting Dynamics CRM. We're talking through the Windows Azure App Fabric Service Bus. This is an old build, so we were having to do a bit of Mickey Mouse stuff. But there is now native support for the App Fabric Service Bus baked into Dynamics CRM. We've now logged into the portal. You'll see we've pulled some information directly out of CRM. Right, so again, hopefully very familiar to people, a web-based portal hosted in Windows Azure front-ending Dynamics CRM. We're now logging in and actually trying to report our service request. We've got a Silverlight app hosted here inside our Windows Azure portal, and we're actually drilling down and saying we're having problems with cellular coverage right here. We're using the Silverlight Bing Maps control. If you haven't seen it, fantastic bit of kit. All right, so we're actually saying we are here. We're at the LACC. Why at the LACC? Because that's where PDC was last year. We're not getting any coverage. We're going to report that. All right, so there's our service request ready to be reported. Now, what we've done is we actually queue and buffer those service requests into the on-premise system. So we push them through a queue in the cloud. The reason we do that is we don't want to get into a situation where we massively scale up in the cloud and end up overloading our on-premise CRM system. And what do I mean when I talk about massively scaling up in the cloud? Well, we thought we'd actually show what we do there. So we created a thing called the Mayhem Generator. The Mayhem Generator is a distributed denial of service attack client with the motivation of creating service requests into our application. Windows Azure is fantastic for scale out. Windows Azure is an ideal platform for testing your applications, or an ideal platform for creating mayhem. So we thought we'd create some mayhem. It's got a Silverlight front end. We're going to tell it to create, maybe not 1,000 this time, maybe just for the purposes of our demo, 100 service requests that are a rate of 10 service requests per second. We're going to run that up. It's going to spin up some worker roles, and it's going to start creating service requests in the cloud. So it's behaving as we would see one of our customers behaving, using our portal in the cloud, and basically filling up this cloud-based queue. We then have that background queue pushing that information in a controlled rate down into our on-premise application. So people grok why we want to do that, right? Because if we basically synchronously couple massive scale in the cloud with not massively scaled on-premise, we're just going to blow the thing to bits. All right, so really common scenario that you're likely to face. And so we've got, hopefully we'll release this sample code at some point in time to show you how to do it. So you'll see we're now buffering these jobs back over the service bus, remember, into our on-premise system. I don't think we're going to wait for all 100 to carry across. So again, really common pattern that you'll want to use when doing cloud to on-prem integration. So you'll now see I have a bunch of service requests that have popped up. And we're going to take advantage of some of the analytics and visualization capabilities to try and work out what's going on our network. Right? So obviously we're seeing all these service requests and we're wondering, you know, what has gone wrong? So we're going to jump and have a look at the dashboard. We're going to have a look at the dashboard in a bit more detail when we come and have a look at some demos actually running inside CRM. Right, so this is really early cut of the dashboard, folks. But you'll see we have a bunch of charts. We now have native dashboarding support in Dynamics CRM. We have dashboarding support that is end user editable, and we're going to build a dashboard in about 4 or 5 minutes' time. So we have a look, we see, heavens, we've had 70-odd service requests created this morning. Right? So we're interested in seeing what is the request type. So we've actually got editable visualizations right here. We've got the end user editing those visualizations. You can see heavens above, right? They're all of the same type. We can have a look over here and see, actually, if we look at requests by tower, it seems that one tower is causing us all of this grief. So let's drill down and actually have a look at some of those service requests. And remember, these towers are geographically dispersed, right? They're basically plonked in the ground all around the place. So we're actually going to take advantage of some custom visualization here. Again, this is an inline visualization where we've, again, rehosted that Bing Maps control. And we can see, yeah, there's quite a lot of data there clustered around one particular area. So what we'll do is we'll drill down into that. And we've got bird's eye view. You don't have bird's eye view in New Zealand yet, unfortunately. Right, but you can see there were people logging calls from the middle of the road on South Figueroa Street. Right? They were so desperate to get their phone working again. We've got a bunch of visualizations in here. So you can choose from a number of visualizations. Those visualizations, again, you can customize as an end user. So let's drill in and have a look at that particular cell tower. And you can see we've got all of the service requests. How does it know those service requests relate to that cell tower, folks? Because we actually do a spatial query. So we take advantage of the fact that we've got SQL 2008 here, right? And we've actually done some work to enable spatial querying. What we're doing here is the same. For that spatial query, combine those requests. Aggregate all of those service requests into a single service request, right? And effectively sort of roll them up into one and say, actually, the tower's broken. We don't need 300 service requests here. We want one service request to send out to our field engineer. So we're going to send that out to the field engineer, and we actually have a workflow that dispatches it out to the service engineer. It's actually going to close it off automatically. And we should be able to go back to our portal and see that that service request is now reporting back into the portal to all of our customers that, you know, actually, we know this tower's down. Please stop panicking, right? Please stop reporting issues from South Figueroa. So you'll see we've now created that alert back into the portal. So these are the sorts of scenarios we talk about when we talk about dynamic CRM really being an application development platform, because that doesn't really feel like a typical CRM scenario to folks, right? We're not selling widgets for Contoso. People are building those already. I mean, at MedRecruit, that's what we've got, right? We have a portal that fronts our business. And so it's a really great use case. And with CRM Online plus Windows Azure, we can build the whole lot in the cloud. So we can have a completely off-premise application with very, very rich functionality. So release timeframe for this. In a few weeks, it keeps on sort of slipping a little. In a few weeks, you're going to be able to get your mittens on the beta. All right? So there's going to be broad public availability of the CRM 2011 beta, and I am showing you a beta tree build today. And also broad availability of beta for CRM Online. So you can spin up a CRM Online account and not have to install anything yourself. CRM Online is going to be the first of Microsoft's products to date that is going to launch to the cloud first. So November this year, there is going to be broad worldwide availability of Microsoft Dynamics CRM Online. Yes, you will be able to buy it in New Zealand, right? Which is really, really neat. And then January 2011, we're going to see the RTM, so you will then be able to pick that up and either partner host it or host it on-premise. Getting into CRM Online is going to be really simple, right? You're going to be able to rock up, complete the capture, punch in some basic details, and you will have a fully functional CRM Online account, including pre-installed sample data, including pre-installed visualization and dashboards. You're going to be able to pay using your credit card, you're going to be able to pay on invoice, and indeed pay through the use of your enterprise agreement licenses. So really flexible licensing options here, and you can add users and additional storage at any time. We've already had a quick look at those visualizations. So arguably CRM 4, and who would agree with me, visualizations were kind of made it tough to compete with certain other CRM platforms. All right, visualizations in CRM 2011 really do kick ass. There's the simple stuff out of the box, and there's an ability to really create quite complex visualizations and dashboards using iframes and web resources and so forth. There's an easy-to-use, browser-driven designer for this stuff. So let's actually jump in and have a wee look at that. So I've got CRM 2011 here. And I've just logged straight in. So you'll see I've got a dashboard here at the moment. My dashboard is blank. We're going to actually create ourselves a dashboard. We're going to start by jumping into the people entity. Right, and we're going to create a custom visualization chart. So inside the people entity, I can pop open the charting area. And you'll see that I have an ability to create a new chart. I've got a contextual ribbon. So you will have noticed that ribbon has just changed. Right, and we just want a simple column chart. And we're going to choose some fields for that chart. So what we're going to do is we're going to take our people and we're going to do a chart of how many customers do we have from all the various cities in our CRM system. So we're going to choose to go address one city, count, and across the x-axis we're going to say we want address one city. You'll see I get a live preview right here. There is my chart. I can then save and close that chart, right? Close the editor, and you'll see I now have a pretty nice visualization. Who thinks their users might quite like that? right? Who has users that bug them all the time to change the dashboard that happens to be a custom ASP.NET page that requires me to go and break out Visual Studio and sit on the couch late at night to update our MedRecruit dashboard? So we actually want a full dashboard though, folks, right? We actually want to mix up maybe some charts, mash up some, maybe some Bing maps and so forth. So we're going to take this and we're actually going to now turn that into a dashboard. So if I head back to dashboards, and again, you don't have to land on dashboards as your homepage. If you want to land on something else as your homepage, that's fully configurable on a user by user basis. So I'm going to collapse up this little help pane because I don't need any help because I'm a veritable expert in this technology. And we'll see I've got the default dashboard here. I actually want to create a new dashboard, so I'm going to jump in and go new. And I want myself a three-column regular dashboard. I'm going to create that. So again, nobody's seen anything here yet that is not usable by end users. Oh, and I've got a pop-up window. Always allow pop-ups, which is going to... Sorry, shifted machines. Have to do that again. Let's try that again. Right, create a new dashboard. And so this is my graphical dashboard editor right here in the browser. And what I want to do here is I want to add in my chart. Right? So I'm going to grab my chart. I'm going to choose my record type. I want the people record or the person record. So it groks singular and plural, which is good for the sort of the anal people in the room, like me. Right? We want to run with the view, so we actually have visualizations distinct from views, right? So that means that you can actually visualize, create a visualization, and then apply that visualization to different views. So we're just going to pick the My Active People view, and then apply our address one, city by address one chart. Bam, so we've now got our first element inside our dashboard. What we're going to do now is we're actually going to jump over here, and we're going to get a tabular list of that data out of the view as well. So I just want to embed a list into my dashboard. I'm going to start by increasing the width of that area because I want a reasonably wide list here. And then if I jump in, I can choose to pick up a record type again, say people. Again, my active people. Okay. So I'm getting live preview in here too, which is quite nice. If I then save and I've got to give it a name. Call it My Cool Dashboard. Hit save and close. And wham bam, thank you, ma'am. We now have a dashboard. Who thinks that's peachy? Yeah? That's pretty sweet, right? You give that to your users, they'll be able to knock themselves out. And there's a whole lot more richness here that we're not going to touch on in this session. Because we got time constraints. Where did my clicker go? Okay, so that was visualizations and dashboards. So the next one is sort of broadly titled user productivity. This is really about making CRM a much richer user experience than what we've been used to. We haven't seen a major rev of the CRM UI since probably 1.2. So it's maybe getting a little bit long in the tooth. So you've already seen some of the ribbon features, right? That ribbon is contextual, as you would have seen when I edited my dashboard. We now have in-form record set navigation. So if you've got a record open, you can now go forward and back in that record set, or you can grab a drop-down and quickly choose another record from the list. We've got rid of tabs. Tabs no longer exist. Instead, we have one long page broken into sections that we can easily jump to. We can now host subgrids really easily in forms without having to break out and just rehost them as an iframe. So we have native support for subgrids in there really, really easily. We also have inline column filtering, so it feels much more like Microsoft Excel. So you don't always have to break out to a custom view to actually do some filtering there in the UI. We now have things like pinned records and views. We have an ability to look up our recently accessed records. Right, so again, familiar to users who have office documents where they can go recently opened. In Outlook, we have follow-up flags, reminders, and better categorization. So the Outlook client has been significantly improved. As you will have seen, we can create and share those dashboards and views, so one user can build a dashboard, easily share that dashboard with other users. So let's jump in and have a look at some of the UI improvements. Okay, so if we see here, we've got some basic customizations here in CRM. When you pick up the training kit material, which we're hoping to sim ship with the beta launch, i.e. when you pick up the beta, you can grab our training kit that we built at the same time. Right? What we've built is we've built a gymnasium management package for Dynamics CRM. So we basically picked up CRM and said, all right, you're going to build a gymnasium and personal training management package. So you'll see we've got workouts, workout templates, exercises, and so forth. We're going to come back and have a look at people. You'll see when I hover over people, there's an ability to pop up this menu. In that menu, I've got fast access, once it's loaded, to all of my views. Yeah? I've also got access to my recently accessed records. In this case, I'm going to pick up the record for Adrian. So you'll see I've now got that people form, that person form, open for Adrian. It's not activated yet in the build I've got, but there's that functionality to shuffle back and forth through the record set. How much is that sweet, right? And an ability to hit that drop-down box and quickly choose another record. You'll see we have no tabs, right? Tabs are gone burger. Instead, the thing formerly known as tabs, right, sit over here in a fast navigable area, but we do have a single continuous form. We have a new feature called connections, and connections allow us to basically create ad hoc connections between any entities in our application. Right. So really useful for creating sort of ad hoc relationships between entities. So what we're going to do is we're going to jump in here and create a connection to me. And I'm going to create a connection to Adrian to indicate that he was a former employee of me. So he was a former employee. And then I can add some notes. I can also add some additional metadata about those connections. So when I define what a connection looks like, that connection can have additional metadata that's carried along. So, for example, I can say that Adrian was a former employee back in, say, January 2007 through to maybe February 2008. Right, so we now have this ability to create these ad hoc connections that we can then interrogate from the application, including when we create advanced find views.
How is it different from the existing relationships?
Because this works with any entity. Right? So it works with any entity, and there's this ability to create additional metadata that goes along with that particular relationship. So we have a really elegant way of having sort of categories of connections. If I save and close Adrian and jump back to my people list, remember I said before we had that filtering capability. So typically, if you wanted to sort of filter a list, how are most people's users doing it? Right? They'd either go here, right? They'd sort and then page, or they'd have to go to advanced find, and really, for some users, that's maybe a little bit beyond them. But most users will have touched Excel at some point in time. Right? Some users just export to Excel and do this anyway. So we can actually jump in here, and we can start doing some custom filtering. So say where full name contains Alex, and that's going to give us a filter on that. Right, so again, bringing these sort of features and democratizing them for users. We're moving really quickly, folks, because we have 1 hour sessions here. I do want to leave a good chunk of time for questions at the end. Outlook. Who uses the Outlook client? Who has users who use the Outlook client? Great. Who thinks it's a little bit rough around the edges? Okay, so there's been a huge amount of work put into the Outlook client. The super good news first. The new Outlook client will work with CRM 4. So you are going to get immediate access to the full functionality of the new CRM Outlook client. It has been massively overhauled. There is support for CRM 2007, 2010, 32 and 64-bit, and I think 2003, I have to have a look when we get towards the end of the system requirements area. It now has native ribbon integration, a true reading pane. Right? It now integrates tightly with native email and meeting forms. Right? So no longer do you have this sort of big distinction between what is a sort of an Outlook Exchange meeting and what is a CRM meeting. It can now handle multiple CRM organisations at once. Anybody that's going to be brilliant for? Because I have the MedRecruit CRM bound into my Outlook, and I want to have the Intigen CRM bound into my Outlook as well. Significantly improved performance and synchronisation. It is far more deployable. Right, so in the past, it has been a bit of a pain to actually get this deployed out to users. So it now has a full sort of Office install experience. It is now much easier to install the multi-user interface versions. We can use System Center Configuration Manager and SMS to deploy this and push it out to users' desktops. It has Windows update support. So that means once it is deployed out to the user desktop, it is going to be updated through the Windows update mechanism. All right, so for those of you in small business type environments where you don't have the luxury of having managed desktops and all of this sort of fancy stuff, get it onto the user's machine. It's going to be updated through Windows Update. There is good cross-version support for the new Outlook client and CRM 2011. What I mean by that is you can use the new Outlook client with CRM 4. You can also use the old Outlook client with CRM 2011. So you have full flexibility as to what sort of schedule you use to upgrade server versus client. So at a minimum, I would encourage you to start, once it's available, upgrading all of your existing 4.0 users to the new CRM 2011 Outlook client. We've got some new changes in sort of data structures to better support team-based work. So we now have a first-class concept of teams inside CRM 2011. Teams can own records. So records no longer need to be owned by an individual. Records can have team ownership. Teams can own queues. Right? So it's far easier to support scenarios where you might have team-based selling. Right? We've already had a look at connections. And so connections give us a very rich way to be able to associate entities and provide additional metadata. And obviously there's going to be better support for SharePoint. So who uses CRM with SharePoint at the moment? Who's ever built something where you have a SharePoint list assigned to each CRM entity? Yeah? That was a bit painful, wasn't it? So there's now native support for that. So you can basically specify with a simple browser-based click-through configuration that for this CRM entity, you want a SharePoint folder per CRM record. Right? Clicky, 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 done. No more having to write code to achieve this. Right? So we can associate a SharePoint set of folders with any CRM entity. So it now means we have document storage without having to go and bastardize notes, right? Without having to create all of your own custom doohickey, who's done some custom doohickey to hold documents. Right? Again, these guys are pretty good at taking feedback. These guys are pretty observant as to what people have been doing out and around the town. It's going to work well with SharePoint Online. So remember, the focus here, we're all in the cloud, right? This stuff is going to work well. So you can build out SharePoint Online, plus CRM 2011 Online, plus Windows Azure, to build a really kick-ass, totally cloud-hosted application. We're looking really hard to pick up MedRecruit and move the whole thing into the cloud. Why is that? Because I hate looking after the server. Right? It is the bane of my existence. So being able to build really rich applications, taking advantage of all of the functionality of Microsoft's big enterprise-scale products in the cloud is going to be pretty trivial. We have a new thing called Dialogues, and this is obviously an early look at the UI. And Dialogues basically allow us to have scripted user interactions. Right? So, for example, we could go through a lead qualification process. Is the customer a friendly customer? Who has some of this sort of stuff built into CRM already? I mean, at MedRecruit, we have on our contact form, we basically have numbered tabs that the salespeople have to go through, and we have workflows bound to each of those tabs so that when they close off each tab, we kick off a whole lot of workflows. Right? This gives you native support for this type of sort of wizard-based, step-by-step guided sales process or guided customer interaction process. And we now have this concept of processes. So processes are a unified way of managing workflows and dialogues. CRM 2011 is the first of Microsoft's products to ship using Windows Workflow Foundation 4.0. And that is, touch wood, going to have significant benefits for those of us who place heavy reliance on workflows. I know in MedRecruit, any point in time, we've probably got between 1,500 and 5,000 active workflows. All right, so we have some pain there too. Mobile support. Again, please let me reinforce. No blogging, no tweeting. Please, 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 I don't want to get my bum kicked. Right? So there's much better mobile support, right? Native mobile support. Mobile is on by default. And in fact, if you're really interested in that, come and see me afterwards, and I can show it running on my iPhone. I didn't manage to get my Windows phone off my colleague this morning because I think he was out last night having a good time. Right, but there is native support for mobile, right? And that means it's really easy for us to build out applications that work quite happily on basically any late model mobile device. iPhone, Windows Phone, Windows Mobile, BlackBerry, Symbian, and so forth. We have much better developer support in terms of building and deploying customizations. The concept of a CRM application lifecycle has kind of been a dirty word, right? Trying to have development staging production environments and rolling changes between them involve quite a lot of heavy-duty script writing because you were basically grabbing different things from different locations. ISV.config was coming in from here, right? You were doing some export of some customizations from here and sort of bundling these through to try and achieve that. So we now have an ability to package components into what are called solutions, and we can distribute those solutions. We can customize the ribbon, right? We can create now role-tailored forms. So that means on a single entity, we can have different views, and different views get shown to different user roles. So in our gym example, we have a membership view of a user, and we have a personal trainer view of a user, because they need to see quite different things for the day-to-day work that they do. We now have native field-level security. Hallelujah, says the guy sitting in the middle here, right? So no more need to jump out to dirty old JavaScript to achieve basic field-level security. Having said that, there is much better JavaScript support, and that JavaScript support acts not on the HTML control anymore, but on an abstract concept of a field. The reason for that is it's going to make it easier to swap out different user interfaces later. So we're no longer tightly coupling that JavaScript to HTML rendering. Right? We want to be able to potentially swap that out with different UI front ends later. We have a drag and drop designer, and obviously you've seen the kick-ass visual dashboard and chart designer. So let's have a quick look at some of these things. So if I jump into settings, who's never seen CRM before? Oh, cool. Only two people. Follow along, going really quick. So if we jump into settings and we have a look at customizations, and we're going to customize our system. I'm not going to drill into solution packaging and so forth. Come to the session that Hadley and I are going to present later in the morning. We'll show you how solution packages and so forth work. So I'm in here in customization. I can look at entities. I can start navigating down this entity tree. I'm going to look at people or person. You'll see this is a much nicer experience than going dialogue after dialogue after dialogue after dialogue inside IE. I'm interested in the forms. So if I have a look at forms, you see I now have two forms. I have a main form, I have a mobile form. If I jump into my main form, I have a nice drag and drop experience. So I might, for example, pick up address 1 UPS zone and dump that in here. Right, so we have a drag and drop experience. We have this idea of sections replacing tabs and so forth. We can rearrange the ordering of these additional elements. Who wants to see the mobile stuff? Cool, everybody likes the mobile stuff. The mobile stuff's pretty sweet, right? So you don't get a fancy ass form designer. Why is that? Well, because actually under the hood, CRM's doing the work to make sure that it looks good on a broad range of devices. So what we get to do is basically just add and remove the fields that we're going to show down on that mobile form. But this will respect field level security. Right? So if we use field level security to specify fields for particular roles, it's going to respect that field level security setting. And as I said, I don't have a webcam, unfortunately. Let me see if I can pull it up just to show that it's not BS. So for those who can see, it just booted me out. Right, that is CRM running on a mobile device. We'll have a look at that outside afterwards. Right, moving along necessarily quickly. Reasonably significant changes around dev support. Obviously, the focus here is to be able to support this idea of online applications. And that support actually carries through some benefits for all developers. We have a concept called sandbox plugins, and Hadley and I are going to discuss that in great detail later on this morning, but sandbox plugins basically allow us to execute code on the server in a trusted fashion. That means that with CRM Online, we can now deploy custom code plugins onto the server. There's great support for building Silverlight and JavaScript HTML types of extensions to your CRM application. So stuff that you would typically have done by throwing an application into the ISV folder, these days can be done by building a Silverlight application, consuming the CRM web services, and then deploying that Silverlight application is what's called a web resource. A web resource allows you to upload a piece of browsable content and have it stored in the CRM database. You can then embed that piece of browsable content into your application somehow. So you might typically embed it into a form. You might embed it into a dashboard. So you build a Silverlight custom component, upload it as a web resource. It's now available at an HTTP GET on WAC web resources, WAC resource name. You can then include that into your CRM dashboard. You can also reference it from other things. So for example, we could upload jQuery into a web resource and then consume that jQuery. So rather than having to write a fully fledged ASP.NET iframe, we just write an HTML page that uses jQuery. That jQuery we consume the OData endpoint provided by CRM 2011. And again, we're going to show a great demo of this later in the morning. We basically have much richer extensibility without actually having to run additional code on the server. Because with CRM Online, if you want to have a custom iframe, you're going to need to shell out and host that in something like Windows Azure. So we have a really manageable level of extensibility where our sort of cost and complexity increases gradually. Where we want to do things that we're not allowed to in a sandboxed plugin, we may want to have that plugin code execute somewhere else. For example, execute on-premise. For example, execute in Windows Azure. So we have native support for the Windows Azure App Fabric Service Bus. It basically means we can go to the plugin registration tool, we can say, make this a remote plugin, and it will automatically hand the plugin context out over the internet to a plugin executing remotely. Who thinks that's pretty neat? All right, so we basically have sandbox plugins, and when we need to pull the emergency shooter, we want to do something particularly interesting or special, right, we can actually use the App Fabric to achieve that. Bunch of options for accessing CRM data. There's a RESTful endpoint. There's full link support, so that's the XML metal, the CRM metal stuff. Right? If you're familiar with the ADX Studio guys, Sean MacArthur and co, they have licensed their link provider for CRM, so it's now really easy to consume that. And we now have just the two authentication approaches for CRM. We have AD authentication, so the native authentication approach, and then we have a full WS trust-based, claims-based auth model, which means that you can use any WS trust-compatible claims provider, or potentially with Windows Azure App Fabric Access Control Service, any old claims provider like OAuth or whatever, to auth users into your application. So if you want to auth users into CRM itself using their Facebook credentials, you can now do that. Anyone got that scenario? Right, not into CRM maybe, but potentially into your portal. We're going to talk about solution packaging in some detail a bit later on in the morning. But solution packages basically allow us to take a set of customizations, define those as a solution package, and create an installable package of those customizations that we can then hand off to our customers if we're an ISV, or hand off to our IS team for dev, staging, production types of deployments. We have an ability to lock down customizations so that end users can't change them any further. We also have an ability to support end user changing and to track dependencies so we don't go and break those end user changes if we make a change later on. Right, so that allows you as an ISV to ship your application to the customer, allow that customer to extend it and not break their changes when you install your updates. It also means we can actually uninstall. Right? Who's ever purchased one of those nice third-party ISV solutions that goes and obliterates your database with the metadata API? And then how do you get the hell of the thing out? Right? So we do actually now support this concept of uninstall. We have a marketplace. Any CRM ISVs in the room? All good. So we now have a marketplace that allows customers to browse and search for your solution. We have an ability to surface your certified for Microsoft Dynamics. And the marketplace is going to grow over time to start having things like native support for CRM. So, for example, you'll be able to browse for a CRM vertical market solution from an ISV, say, please try. It will spin up CRM online for you, push your package in there, and basically let that user try your application out. Much better support for on-premise deployments, including support on the server side for update through Microsoft Windows Update. Easier to do internet-facing deployments, no more faffing around with the IFD tool, which is good. Better PowerShell support for actually managing your application, particularly for spinning up new orgs and so forth. There's now a System Center Ops Manager pack, so it makes it easier to integrate CRM into your overall enterprise application monitoring strategy. In terms of requirements, so on the desktop, we're going to support Windows 7, Vista, and XP with IE 7 or IE 8. There is a dependency on IE. I'm going to reinforce that. For those who don't know about it, there is a dependency on IE. For those who do know about it, there is still a dependency on IE. You're going to support for the plugin Office 2003, Office 2007, Office 2010, both 32-bit and 64-bit. Anyone using 64-bit Office, please don't, right? So 64-bit Office is available, but if you're running 64-bit Windows, please don't assume you should be running 64-bit Office. 64-bit Office is designed for a pretty rare set of edge case scenarios. Namely, if you're a math geek and you need to run Excel with more than 4 gigs of available address space. Please don't go installing 64-bit Office. It means you can't install certain 32-bit add-ins. It becomes a total pain in the neck. Yes, you're running 64-bit Windows, stick with 64-bit Windows, 32-bit Office. There ends the public service announcement. .NET 4 support, so it is now using .NET 4 down on the client for the Outlook add-in. And it uses SQL Server Express 2008. For Mobile Express, basically any mobile browser that has decent JavaScript support and you're ready to rock. For developers, we're using Visual Studio 2010, and there are some developer tools coming that I can't talk about much more today. For IT folks, your pick of acronym. On the server, there is a 64-bit dependency. I shall repeat that with reinforcement. There is a 64-bit dependency. So if you're not running 64-bit Windows Server 2008 or above, you are going to have some problems. SQL Server 2008, there is not a 64-bit dependency on that, and in fact, I need to change that point. You can still run with a 32-bit database server. I hope there aren't any people running 32-bit database servers anymore. The email router, again, requires 64-bit server, or you can run the email router on Windows 7 if you really feel that way inclined. Exchange, very broad support for Exchange from Exchange 2007 on, including Exchange Online. Again, SharePoint support for both 2007 and 2010, so that native SharePoint support will still work with your existing 2007 SharePoint servers. There's no need to upgrade to SharePoint 2010 to take advantage of those great features, and it will work as well with SharePoint Online. With that, we have got 8 minutes for questions. Who found that useful? Right, leave your hand up if you've got a question. Oh, bollocks, I thought I'd try something different. Okay, gentleman at the front here.
Can it take advantage of branch cache?
Can it take advantage of branch cache?
For, like, remote sites. So server 2008 branch cache.
I have absolutely no idea. Not a single clue in the world. I don't even know what branch caching is. So what I'd love for you to do is if you email me, chris.auld@intergen.co.nz, tell me a little bit about what branch caching is, give me some MSDN pointers, ask me the question, I will go and ask the product group, and if I'm allowed to talk about it publicly, post the answer on my blog so everybody gets the benefit. We'll go for one at the back. Document generation, you're still going to be writing some custom code, right? So there's no native document generation outside of doing a merge, a mail type merge in Word. Now, I haven't tried it yet, but there's a possibility that you could do some sort of mail merge, maybe with Word services in SharePoint 2010. Don't know any of you guys. Got any thoughts on that, my team? No? You're probably still going to be shelling out to a plugin and doing either ASPOs or OpenXML document generation.
Did they change any of the email editing functionality? So, you know, apparently, if you want to have some proper formatting,
Yeah, I haven't looked at it in great detail, so I probably can't answer that yet. Again, email me. I will follow some of these up and do a blog post for you. Gentleman at the back? Yes. From memory, I'm not sure.
It was an answer.
What? Give me an answer. The answer is it's not available to everybody yet. There will be a beta available in a few weeks.
But the beta may not work with
CRM4. The beta may not work with CRM4. Not sure yet. Again, I hate to be sit on the fence-ish. This stuff is somewhat fluid. Yes. So Silverlight web parts will sync offline, right? So web resources. Remember those web resources that you upload a piece of content that can then be downloaded? So you can create a Silverlight component that might sit in a dashboard, deploy it as part of a solution package, right? Deploy it into your application. When you go offline with the offline capability in the Outlook add-in, it's going to take that Silverlight component, that ZAP file, offline and make it available to dashboards in the offline client when you're working offline.
Do you know if you can hook into the content delivery network for the jQuery stuff and web resources?
So the question was around hooking into a CDN for jQuery and so forth. You can easily enough reference third-party JavaScript libraries, CSS libraries, and have them globally available to all scripts in your application now. So there'd be no problem with saying, rather than serving jQuery out of a CRM web resource, I'll serve jQuery out of, say, Google's CDN network or out of Microsoft's Windows Azure CDN. Yeah. Don't know. Let's have a quick look. I didn't go hunting for it. Let's have a quick look. So it looks like, no, there's no sort of form assistant type thing. Yes. So there will be reasonable backward compatibility support. So in fact, all of your existing plugins and so forth will work. A few things, pardon? Supported ones, right? I assume that we only ever do supported customizations because we're really, you know, careful at doing that. So your plugins will work. Probably the one thing I would try to steer clear of at the moment is custom workflow activities. If you're using custom workflow activities are one thing that's definitely not going to be supported in CRM Online. So if you're using lots of custom workflow activities, you probably want to come up with some other solution to do that. And you can pretty easily turn a custom workflow activity into a plugin with a bit of sort of bastardization and sort of flag setting in an entity. Beyond that, no, you should have a reasonably okay migration path. Yes. Not really in 4. Because if you're trying to do those sorts of things in 4 at the moment, you really are shelling out to JavaScript and doing things like that. So the one thing you probably do need to be a bit conscious of is things like using tab hiding and so forth to create role-based type forms. Obviously, that's not the approach to use going forward. So just try and make it so that you can potentially plug out that approach later on. Don't know. I have to go and drill down. I'm assuming that it's just going to be the same requirements as the SQL box. Yeah. Sorry, there's. Yeah. Oh, there's no tabs. What I mean by no tabs, I'm not talking about no IE tabs. Although typically CRM users don't use IE tabs. What I'm saying is that in CRM 4, there used to be tabs across the page here that would basically represent these same section breakouts that you see down the side here. Guys, we are probably 1 minute off. One more, maybe.
Just on the tabs, then the new Outlook client actually lets you turn up different forms inside the tabs inside Outlook.
Yeah, so the Outlook client has a pretty sweet UI. You know, it's a pretty compelling proposition now, whereas it, you know, used to be a bit of a pain. Sorry, we'll grab this one and I will take your one, sir.
In terms of the mobile client, you said there's field level security. Is there any room for putting other validation in on the mobile?
No, no validation beyond the sort of validation that you get natively for CRM attributes. So again, if you do lots of work where you do stuff in JavaScript, you do lots of JavaScript magic, that's not going to carry so well across to the mobile experience. Yeah, the last question. No comment. Folks, that's us. I will be hanging outside for a few minutes. If you want to see the mobile client running on an iPhone, do come and see me. Thank you for coming along. Please do your evals. Do appreciate all constructive, deconstructive, reconstructive, or otherwise instructive criticism, comment, and feedback. Thank you for coming along.